Mr. Tarrou, in this calculus lesson, we're going to be doing two examples of finding limits of functions that involve absolute value functions within them. This is going to be a continuation, of course, of us finding limits using properties of limits. If you want more examples, there'll be a link in the description of this video. But I saw these problems recently and thought they were rather interesting and not something I've done in the past. So one thing you're going to see over and over again through this year, that as we deal with functions that involve absolute values, we're going to be setting up piecewise functions because, of course, you know, an absolute value function tells you how far a number is away from zero on the number line. And if you have a positive number like the absolute value 5, well, you count back, you're 5 units away from the number, from zero on the number line. And the absolute value of negative 5. Well, the absolute value of negative 5 is 5 units away from zero on the number line, even though I think I just moved my hand 4 times, but, you know, you get the point. So we're going to be, through limits, through derivatives, and through integration, we're going to be rewriting these problems in terms of a piecewise function. You can also say that it's also the square root of something squared. I have a derivative video like that, and later, as I've had more experience with calculus teaching it to my students, the piecewise idea is much simpler. So we're going to remember that something interesting happens with absolute values at that point along the number line, or at some value that allows the expression inside the absolute value to equal zero. Like I said, absolute value 5 is positive 5. It doesn't do anything. To the left of zero, though, the absolute value is going to change the sign of that value. So what makes this expression inside the absolute value symbol equal to zero? Well, of course, that's going to be x equals 2. So there's no coincidence that we're being asked to find the limit as x approaches 2. Something interesting is happening there. Really, for two reasons. Not only do we have an absolute value function in our expression, but of course, we also have x minus 2 in the denominator. And as we saw with our earlier lessons and the other practice in your homework, that, you know, if you're going to find the limit of this expression using properties of limits, you want to rewrite this expression into some other form that allows us to plug in the value of 2. Come up with an expression or function that agrees with this function everywhere except x equals 2. Well, how do we do that? Well, just like all the other problems in your homework, we're going to factor the numerator and maybe hopefully see it cancel with some kind of factor in the denominator, allowing us to plug in 2, but at the same time, let's set up that piecewise function. We're going to have, let's say, f of x is equal to, and that bracket's going to need to be bigger, but it's going to be equal to, well, let's see, let's go to the left of 2. If we plug in a value that's to the left of 2, or less than 2, like 3, I'd be to the right, how about 1? 1 minus 2 is negative 1, and the absolute value of negative 1 is positive 1. You have to change that sign. So if we let the condition be that x is less than, not 0, but 2, we're going to have x squared plus 3x minus 10 over, now we're going to take this absolute value function out and replace it with a set of negative parentheses, so that we account for the idea that if we plug in an x value that's less than 2, like 1, 1 minus 2 is negative 1. We got to change the sign of that as we take the absolute value, and, you know, of course, have it be positive 1. So we introduce the negative parentheses to account for what those absolute values function or notation would do. But when x is greater than 2, like 3, 3 minus 2 is 1, and the absolute value of 1 is just 1. The absolute value symbol doesn't actually do anything. So we have x squared plus 3x minus 10 over x minus 2. Well, now that we have our piecewise function set up, let's kind of, and notice I didn't do like an equal sign here because I'm doing some side work. You know, all of this right here is not equal to this limit notation. I'm just getting ready to do that. And we have a quadratic in the numerator that's easily factorable, so let's go ahead and do that. And you can see now, like we did when we were graphing rational functions in Algebra 2 or maybe even Algebra 1, and certainly in our other homework problems we've had so far where we're talking about finding these limits using properties of limits and not having to do those annoying tables and graphs, that this common factor of x minus 2 is going to cancel out of each of these expressions. And we also have a negative that's down here in the denominator. That's going to, you know, x minus 5 divided by negative 1 is going to be the same as negative 1 times x plus 5. Did I say x plus 5 there, right? I hope. And let's get this rewritten one more time. And I made some graph paper so I could show you what this graph looks like, but it's going to be getting in the way. So let's get that out of here for now. Put that back up in a second. We have f of x is equal to negative x minus 5 when x is less than 2 and x plus 5 when x is greater than 2. Now, of course, this is negative x minus 5 because we're letting this negative 1 in the denominator, x divided by negative 1 and 5 divided by negative 1 is negative x minus 5. Now let's bring in that limit notation again. What's going on here? Well, you notice that there's no indication of a plus or minus in this upper right-hand corner. That means we're being asked for a two-sided limit. Well, with piecewise functions, of course, when you have a different expression to the left of 2 and to the right of 2, you can't just plug, we're not just going to plug 2 into some kind of expression. It's got to be broken up. So what I'm going to really write here now is that we're looking at the limit as x approaches 2 of f of x. It's a piecewise function, though. And the only way that a two-sided limit exists is if the left and right-hand limits are equal. So what we really need to do is find out what's the limit as x approaches 2 from the left of what I've renamed this function f of x. Well, we're going to plug in something to the left of 2. Well, now, here, if I do 2 minus 2, I get 0, and I can't divide by 0, so I'd have to, like, kind of do some table, again, to approach from the left to right. But I've rewritten with the factory, and I was able to rewrite this expression, so we have now just simply negative x minus 5, so when we're approaching from the left. And I'm going to plug 2 into this expression. I'm going to write 2, you know, not like 1.999, because by writing 2 or plugging or substituting 2 into the expression defined for when x is less than 2, then I'm taking care of or showing that I'm using that left-hand side, and we get negative 2 minus 5 is negative 7. Now if I plug in or think about, again, two-sided limit, let's check the left, now let's check the right. Well, if we're using values to the right of 2 or greater than 2, we're plugging it into this other expression and we have 2 plus 5 is equal to 7. Well, our left and right-hand limits are not equal. As x approaches 2 from the left, we have negative 7. As x approaches 2 from the right, we have positive 7. So the limit as x approaches 2 of f of x, that answer is going to be undefined. Now, if I bring back my graph paper here a little bit, I love that thing, we see, you know, if we wanted to take a look at this problem graphically, when you come back here to the original problem, it looks like we have some kind of parabola, but we have a second degree expression being divided, again, in two parts because of the absolute value, but some kind of single degree expression. So what looks like maybe be a parabola, of course, is just simply a line. And after we've set up the piecewise function based on the break in the absolute value and looking at to the left and the right of 2, we have negative 5, so we have a y-intercept of negative 5, and we have a slope of negative 1. So all those points represent, you know, some kind of connection for that line, in case you needed some help graphing piecewise functions. We have x is y is equal to x plus 5, so we're looking at a y-intercept of 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We have a slope in front of our x value, of course, of 1. We're all in calculus, we should know that, of course. And we have this graph of the piecewise function, but of course that's not really correct. We're just using the negative x minus 5 for x values that are less than 2. So as we come through here, we're going to come to 2, put an open dot, because of course x cannot be 2, you can't divide by 0. And to the right of 2, well, I got this whole line drawn, but really the only part that I want is to the right of 2. And here you can see one more time, as we approach 2 from the left, we have negative 7, and as we approach 2 from the right, we have that value of positive 7. And that's our first example. Now, our second example is going to be a little bit harder because it'll be very similar, quadratic in the numerator, absolute value in the denominator, but we're not going to be able to cancel out that expression that we're getting from the denominator. What's that going to look like? So for our last example, we have the limit as x approaches 3 of x squared minus 5x plus 4 over x minus 3. Now, with this one, we can see the numerator is, again, another very easily factorable polynomial, and we have x squared minus 5x plus 4. Well, that's going to factor to be, that's going to factor to be x minus 4 times x minus 1. Great. But neither one of these factors is, of course, going to work with or handle very well that absolute value of x minus 3. It's not going to do any cancellation. So for this particular problem, we can rewrite it again into that piecewise function like we showed in the previous example. Or we can understand that really kind of like nothing very interesting is going to happen here in terms of being able to algebraically manipulate this into a form that's going to allow us to use this x value of 3, let x approach 3. So we can say, well, we're going to find the limit as x approaches 3 from the left for this expression. And right off the top of my head, my calculator, we can say, well, let's go ahead and let x approach 3 from the left. Let's go ahead and use the value of 2.99. And when you work that out, that's going to come out to be negative 200.99. And as you want to find the limit as x approaches 3 from the right, understanding that we're going to have to come in from, come into 3 on the, from the right, 4, 3.5, 3.2, 3.1, we're going to get this. And that comes out to be negative 1, and the calculator just turned off, negative 198.99. And we can also look at this graphically, but this time, with there being no way to deal with that factor in the denominator of x minus 3, and of course you can't really deal with that factor of x minus 3 until you rewrite this into a piecewise function so you can allow that to actually cancel, because you can't just cancel an expression that's inside of an absolute value function. But you're going to have a vertical asymptote at x minus 3, kind of like think back with your skills in algebra 2 and pre-calculus, that when you were graphing rational functions, if you had a factor in the denominator that was able to cancel, you'd have a hole in the graph. Oh, we didn't have a hole in the previous example because of having the extra complexity of the absolute value function there. But if you had a factor in the denominator that did not cancel, you'd end up with vertical asymptotes. Well, you also know now that we're dealing with, like trig functions, that when you have a factor in the denominator that, that can be, or some kind of term that can be zero, you don't always get vertical asymptotes, like the limit as x approaches zero of the sine of x over x. The graph does not have a vertical asymptote there at x equals zero. But this one is going to, because you don't have any fancy trig functions or anything going on there. And I don't remember what this graph looks like off the top of my head, but as you approach 3 from the left and the right, it's going to be going down to infinity on both sides. So the limit as x approaches 3 of x squared minus 5x plus 4 over the absolute value of x minus 3 comes out to be negative infinity. Now, really, when we deal with limits, we want real values. And I've had some viewers on YouTube kind of agree and disagree with my videos that I've posted for my calculus. Like, we have a section about infinite limits. And really, by me saying that the limit as x approaches 3 for this expression, saying that it's negative infinity, I am actually saying that there is no real limit. But by identifying it as negative infinity, both of course approaching negative infinity from the left and the right, from this statement I can see a behavior that I would have in the graph, and that is the end of my second example. Again, if you need more examples or discussions, lessons about limits, we'll have a link in the description as well to my entire calculus playlist that's organized by chapter and topic. But for now, I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework! And if you're still watching, I just want to send out a thank you for all the prayers and well wishes and thoughts sent our way as we were preparing for Hurricane Irma. We came through just fine. We were very, very blessed, and we're sending our prayers out to everyone that is rebuilding, still suffering without their, you know, place to live, without power, having struggles with food and getting gas and all that stuff. Our thoughts and prayers go out to those, and thank you so much for those you sent our way. Thank you.